Sal Mubarak. Wish you a very happy new year. Gurmeet Rai just came from Delhi. And I was in Delhi for one day, but I also have a little bit of a throat. So the travel advice for Delhi is negative. I'm very happy to see somebody who I think we all value very important in the field of living heritage. We were lucky to have Jigna and Bikramjit upstairs. And I think that you're going to enjoy this talk. It's a talk about hope. It's a talk about maybe seeing things in a different way. And it's also a talk about hard work. I very clearly remember my first interaction that was in Chennai 7 years ago, 6 years ago, where I thought, wow, this is a lady who knows how to make conservation architecture or living heritage work. Of course, you know her work in Amritsar, and I will give the word for the official introduction to our chair of conservation architecture, Associate Professor Jigna Desai.
Thank you very much, Anna, for your very kind introduction to me. It's indeed a pleasure to welcome Gurmeet to the university and have her share her work with us, her ideas with us. I'm supposed to do the formal introduction, so we'll just put in some facts that I've found. Gurmeet is a conservation architect based in New Delhi. She established CRCI, Cultural Resource Conservation Initiative, in 1996. The firm has undertaken a wide range of projects within the domain of cultural heritage conservation and management, its management practices in India. The firm does a range of projects, once again, from documentation, historic building conservation, heritage management, and policy making. The firm has worked with, and she has worked with, local bodies, national bodies, and international bodies such as UNESCO. Projects have received numerous awards. Significant amongst them are the Asia Pacific Architectural Heritage Awards by UNESCO. She is associated with the World Monuments Fund and is a vice president for ICOMOS India, as it's written out there. I personally think that her ideas of conservation are path-breaking, and they connect cultural heritage and sustainable development quite seamlessly and in a very unique manner. One of my favorite initiative of hers, which I got to know later that it's her initiative, is the Collect Punjab initiative, which where communities share their stories is what the official introduction is. But what I believe is that it works with the local narratives of multiple histories and brings out the salient feature of cultural development and cultural heritage in the forefront of the ideas of conservation. So yes, welcoming Gurmeet for the lecture, and really looking forward to listening to you.
Good evening. I'm going to try and be as audible as possible. This is probably those of you who's. I mean, I think I'm sounding like Jigna, I suddenly thought, you know, which is a nice, you know, kind of voice. Anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. I remember when we joined College of Architecture, so I said, okay, where do you want to really study? And it was CEPT that was like the top of our list of colleges where we wanted to. I did my graduation from Chandigarh, but thank you so much for inviting me here. The presentation that the part of my work that I would share through this presentation has a lot to do with tourism, but that's not something which I trained in. It just happened that I seem to be drawn, people seem to draw me towards tourism more than I work consciously towards it. And I think we can discuss that, why does that happen? I do happen to be part of the International Scientific Committee on Cultural Tourism, which is an international body. Again, by accident, I won't say that I'm a specialist in tourism because that's not my worldview on heritage. What I'm going to do in this particular presentation is walk you through how do we, I mean, my own personal journey in cultural heritage, as a cultural heritage management practitioner is what I would see myself as. And the way it's kind of gone into the area of, I mean, went into the area of tourism. Now, when I began my work as a cultural heritage practitioner, the body that one wanted to engage with was either the Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage, thank you so much, or the Archaeological Survey of India. And we found that extremely difficult because at that point, when I'm talking about the early 90s, cultural heritage conservation and management was very much within the domain of the Archaeological Survey of India. And they did have their definition of what is heritage and what is these monuments that needed to be fixed. And then, of course, there was a spurt, and you had the National Trust that was founded in 1984. And there were some professors who later became my professors as when I was studying in School of Planning in Delhi. They were working on historic cities and urban areas and so on, and looking at heritage a little differently than what this country's, you know, the institution like ASI was looking at. So it was quite a difficult task to get any kind of resources to actually get down to conservation of heritage. But we finally found a window to engage with heritage, and that was through Ministry of Tourism. Now here, I mean, one can, you can sit back and reflect that why, how come a lot of us as heritage professionals found that we were actually got an opportunity to work was through the tourism ministries. So we are looking at tourism, I mean, you're looking at a country which has a tourism policy, and whereas you have no cultural heritage policy, really, at the national level. So if you're looking at, but we have an act for cultural heritage, which is the Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act, but you don't have a tourism act, you know, so it's quite interesting that how these two ministries work. So the ministry that we're really looking at for tourism area is Ministry of Tourism, Ministry of Culture, Ministry of Environment and Forest, Urban Development, Railways, Civil Aviation. And why are these ministries there to work with tourism in the first place? It's because we're looking at three areas which tourism understands as something they need to address with because they are addressing a particular demand. And one is improved access. The other is board and lodging for the visitors. And the third is publicity and promotion. That is primarily the frame within which the tourism industry looks at tourism development in the country. Similarly, at the state level, you have exactly, it kind of mirrors itself. It's very important to understand governance if you want to engage with, the moment you step out of a college situation and you want to work in the market, you've got to understand governance the moment you're looking at public asset. Now, I'm going to just talk about cultural tourism destination or cultural tourism and not natural heritage, tourism around natural heritage here. So the point is, what does it really mean if you've got to make a destination? Looking at those three areas of intervention, the way the government looks at it, about infrastructure driven. But the mandate on looking at heritage itself, what exactly is this heritage, lies with somebody else. So what does it mean? My worldview on this is that it's about, if you're really looking at developing a destination, you're talking about place making. Because I prefer the word travel to tourism. And why does somebody travel is, to my mind, it is about personal enrichment. So you're going to a particular place to experience it. And the experience is not in little bits and pieces. It's not about one site, one street, one shopping mall or something. It's about a whole ecosystem of a place that you're looking at. How your senses, what you perceive through your senses is one thing, but you're also looking for information. You're looking for stories of that place, because that's what human touches people, is the stories of that place. And then, of course, is active engagement. Because it's not just about seeing and, you know, it's just not about entertainment. It's through engagement that the process is much more enriching. So for me, these are the three important components of any placemaking. And what makes this ecosystem is nature, culture, people, which comprise tangible and intangible heritage. I'm sure you've heard of all this. And what makes cultural heritage, it comprises the built heritage, the documentary heritage. When I say documentary, I'm talking about something which is movable. And then the intangible, you know, the processes that you see. Similarly, natural heritage. Now, just an example, like in Punjab, like just a view of that, that we're looking at a place like Patiala. You've got its museums, you've got this Bade Gulam Ali Khan Sahib came from there, so you've got the music, the gharana there, you're looking at the crafts there, looking at museums, the markets, and, you know, a lot of living traditions, everything that, you know, the knowledge system, like here, when you walk the walled city, there is a knowledge with this particular person, the creative industries of a particular place. So for me now, when I'll come to that point, you've got your built heritage, you've got your infrastructure, and then you have the livelihoods around this. And then within, this kind of goes and connects with a larger hinterland. It's more or less like what Patrick Geddes talks about, the relationship between a built environment and the rural hinterland. And I can see that kind of emerging in my own head through my own work, you know. A basic expectation of the visitor is ease of access, authentic heritage with its built heritage, performing arts, crafts, living traditions. You're really looking at something which I do hold on to the word authentic, because I think when I look at the work of government and I say, you know, when they want to, they trivialize heritage by, you know, kind of making imitations and so on. The assumption that a visitor or a tourist is a stupid person, I think it's doing a lot of disservice to people who make the effort to travel. Efficient and accessible visitor amenities and infrastructure, and safe and clean overall environment of the setting. This is something very basic. So it's not just about managing your heritage and conserving your heritage. You've got to look at, understand what a visitor is looking at. Now this particular triangle, I'm not going to walk you through this because it's very dense, but I'm going to leave this presentation for you people to think about. Somewhere about four years ago, we were involved by UNESCO signed an MOU with Government of Punjab to do a cultural heritage policy for the state. The question that I was asking at that point, and I was the built heritage team, you know, again, it was built heritage, documentary heritage, and intangible heritage. There were three groups. And then there was a lead consultants team that kind of taking out the essence of all the work that was happening. The question that I was asking myself was that no matter what you want to do to this heritage, you know, I mean, you've got the local community, which is, you know, there holding that heritage. We come in as professionals. We're trying to do something to this heritage. We're trying to understand it and create some environment for somebody who's going to come and consume it. But why is heritage looking the way it is looking? Why is our environment looking the way it is looking? Should we be doing something to understand that? Why is our behavior as a host community, and I empathize very much with the host community, because the example I'm telling you about, sharing with you, is the state I come from. That why are we abusive of our own heritage? And why are we trying to, why does somebody else have to come from outside and decorate it and improve it and so on for somebody else to consume? There's something fundamentally wrong with that. And to my mind, we started probing this question that what do you need to do to be able to make to have a behavior change in our own selves, through our own selves, that we manage our heritage as part of our own intrinsic character, which somebody comes and looks at and appreciates. Why does it have to be an externally aided thing? So we came out with these three triangles, and and what we really want to achieve is behavior change. The triangle talks about the problem right on top, causes for that problem, and the interventions that are necessary. And what you're trying to do is address cultural heritage management. So the way we were looking at it is that there's inadequate recognition, protection, conservation, and management of built heritage. It's a question. What are the causes? Is it low priority, current legal systems which are not responsive to heritage? Something to do with the organizational structures and capacities? Something to do with financial resources? We're looking at just built heritage here. And the nature of an intervention that the state must do to bring a better, a more healthy environment as far as built heritage is concerned. The second triangle was, okay, fine. As professionals, we want heritage better managed. But should it just be managed for the sake of managing heritage, or should it be doing something else? And the question was that, can it contribute to the quality of life of the inhabitants, of the people who are the carriers of this particular tradition, of a way of life? And the question was that people's collective and individual initiative is not recognized or enabled as should be for sustained growth and vitality. Heritage is not static, it is dynamic. What are the causes, what are the sub-causes, and what are the interventions that are necessary to, and, you know, simple intervention, like for instance, like 2.0, there's the one way down there. We're talking about create decentralized institutions to encourage creative expressions in the area of performing arts and cultural industries. Say you go to Paris, you'll go to the Pompidou Center, and you'll see that, you know, spaces are used by people and people celebrate their life. Why does it become a drudgery here, you know? Why are our performing artists kind of treated the way they're treated? Why is there no recognition and a sense of self-esteem in those artists? You know, I'm talking about the folk artists, I'm not talking about the classical. What is the problem that we are still working in silos and living lives in silos? So we have to have a paradigm shift to the way we look at our own way of life, if you really want to make a difference. The third was about sustainable development. Culture is not recognized as one of the three pillars of sustainable development framework. This is much before the sustainable development goals came out. And so again, the same thing, what do you need to do to integrate that as part of our sustainable development framework? I mean, surely all of us can't intervene in all areas. But if you're talking about as architects, planners, if you're looking at public space needs to have, you know, it has to be thought through by, I think the 20th century planners have not done service to what should have been done. Or the 20th century has done disservice to planners, whichever way you want to look at. There's definitely a problem. And I think, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I see myself engaging with in educational institutions more from this perspective, that we've got to relook at where, how we are perceiving our physical space. Now, this particular project, again, I'm going to talk about two projects here. I mean, my work in Punjab or in cultural heritage is my, no two projects look identical. I mean, and I see myself revisiting the same site again after every 3 or 4 years, whether it's the Golden Temple or the Grand Trunk Road or Ellora Caves or whatever. It's quite interesting that when you watch your own life as you go by doing different works, if you're kind of engaging with some key fundamental questions, you'll see that you visit the same site and your perspective is enhanced, or your palette of questions is enhanced. But interesting enough, when I look at the work of my own organization, at no point do I look at my documents and I feel that, look, I could have done this better. The question has a right, and it's a very fulfilling experience, because some question we were asking and we got an answer, you're revisiting the site after 3 years, you have a different question. But the question that the answer that you got 3 years ago for another particular question is not dated, as far as my own personal growth is concerned. So the two projects I'm going to talk about is an inclusive tourism infrastructure development project for Punjab, which was a loan that government of Punjab took. And I can sound a little immodest among fellow architects and students, is that I would say I was instrumental in Punjab taking this loan of 300 crores to invest in the sector of heritage and tourism. My work in Punjab started about two decades ago, with fixing little buildings and it upscaled to larger buildings through and larger sites through the tourism department. It further upscaled through the ADB project, then doing the cultural heritage policy. And now I am doing a lot of, when I say I've got a lot of my young people with me, so that's the big I, it's not just me. Richard is sitting here, she's part of that. And now we are engaged in the city of Amritsar as the city Hriday anchors for the under the Government of India Ministry of Urban Development program to look at infrastructure development in a historic city. So it's a very interesting, it's a very satisfying engagement. And I was talking to Anne about this, that, you know, I see the need for more and more students engaging with the real life. It's like a laboratory, because from what the Ministry of Culture can do, through what you can achieve through a Ministry of Tourism and what you can achieve through a Ministry of Urban Development are three different scales of intervention in the same city. So we were involved with first in 2007 to develop a roadmap for tourism in India, of which Punjab project is a part. And the finding was that when visitors go to a particular place, they are not bound by political or geographical or administrative boundaries. They have a particular interest, and so therefore they travel trans states. So the objective of this project was to find these linkages, find these thematic clusters or circuits that visitors like to go to. It also came out responding to the fact that international visitors in any part of the country, and here I'll give the example of northern India, fly into Delhi. But they may be going to Dharamsala, or they may be going to Ladakh, or they may be going to Amritsar or Banaras. So the possibility that they enter the country in a decentralized manner, and they don't consider Delhi as only point of entry. So these gateway destinations were identified as part of the roadmap. So in the case of Punjab, it was seen that, okay, Amritsar has a potential for being one of the gateway destinations, and so does Chandigarh. And these two particular cities would address the northern part of the country. So you could either go to Himachal or to Jammu and Kashmir and so on. So move away from Delhi and look at this larger interstate relationship. The key issues that were identified as part of this particular project was about the last mile connectivity. This project was not about building big airports and highways, but to find the last link, you know, the last mile connectivity to take you to the site that you want to go. So it could be up to 50 kilometers and no longer. It also said that the environmental management and visitor support infrastructure at main cultural and natural sites was very poor, so that needed improvement. It also found out that the cultural heritage and natural heritage sites were in a very, very poor state of conservation and management. And then finally, weak economic and physical linkages between main destinations and communities. These were the four physical challenges that were identified. So connectivity, heritage, conservation, and site management, linkages with communities so that they get the benefit, and the visitor support infrastructure like the visitor amenities and so on. So it looks pretty straightforward, but it took a lot of, anything which looks very simple means there's a lot of thinking has gone behind that. Then of course there were the non-physical constraints, and I'm not going to talk about non so much as the physical needs, since we're all architects and planners. Three types of destinations were identified. gateway destination, natural heritage destinations, and cultural heritage destinations. A template was developed because our client was the Ministry of Finance and Tourism here, because a loan had to come from the Asian Development Bank. A very interesting thing came out of the study was that things don't exist in isolation. If you have a destination which is rich in culture, it does not mean it will not have natural heritage. Similarly, something which is rich in natural heritage will have some bit of culture. So we were very mindful of the fact that the template that we developed, any site which is rich on natural cultural heritage, for instance, Amritsar, was bound to have something to do with nature as well. So we must have something to do with nature. Similarly, if you pick up a wetland, there's bound to have some cultural heritage, some, you know, intangible or tangible around. The reason being that we were perfectly aware that our stakeholders were either the Department of Culture or the Department of Forest. And you don't want to call a particular destination by this or the other, because the departments are into the business of working in silos. So the moment you pick up a wetland, the Department of Forest is going to tell the Department of Culture, you guys don't need to come here, we will work on this site. So finally, at the end of it, no matter what kind of integrated thinking you're going to put in the report, people are going to again go back into their silos. So we must have a bit of culture in nature and a bit of nature in culture. And then, of course, how thematic clusters were identified. And this is basically the framework of Asian Development Bank. I'm going to get to a more exciting bit and come to Hriday as well. And it didn't tell me how many minutes I have to, you know, kind of go on with my narrative. Because, yeah, okay, till I see people blinking, kind of dozing off, I guess. So, destination cluster selection, attraction selection, and gateway selection. Again, those of you who are interested can look at it later, that what kind of, what were the parameters that were considered to identify these different types of, because when I come to Punjab, I'll show you how it all kind of plays out. And how thematic tourism destinations within that, whether your nature, culture, or gateway, based on the nature of resource, the themes of resource, you have to identify the what were your main types of your assets, the kind of people who come, who is your audience, the kind of sites they go to. So the moment it's a cultural heritage destination with a bit of nature, you've got to see what kind of, the mapping of that particular area determines the kind of themes that you had. For instance, you have the Satluj River heritage route, or you have the Freedom Trail, or the Bias River heritage route, and within that, the main destination theme, the main sites, and the key interventions that were identified. To work with a community seems like most simple when you walk into the site, but most complex because, you know, when you look at the lifespan of projects, physical infrastructure takes the shortest and the least amount of time for both planning and implementation. It could be 1 to 3 years. When you look at cultural heritage, typically you need 5 to 10 years. And if you have to work with communities, it could be 10 to 20 years, could be a lifetime. I mean, if you have examples of Ilabat and these very, very important, you know, kind of amazing people who worked with communities, even Devashish is here as well. To work with communities, you've got to really engage for a long time. So to be able to understand, I mean, this is something which is not quite well understood. In most cultural heritage and tourism projects is where to begin, because it's normally understood, let's get the roads going because somebody wants to get the indicators of things are moving, and this is where the big spend is going to be. If you're taking 300 crores, surely if there is 20 crores for community, 100 crores for heritage, and 150 for infrastructure. So that's the kind of, even 100 won't go to heritage, maybe a little less, but in Punjab we ensured more than 100 goes into heritage. But the lifespan of each of these projects is very important to understand that in good project planning, and at least my generation has not been able to make a significant breakthrough in that. But some, I guess the next gen needs to work, and I'm sure institutions of heritage management that Devashish has started here is going to address these particular needs, that you start talking about people first and start the processes way in, in the beginning, so that you get, and the linkages you make with institutions and incubators, local incubators and institutions, that when the lifespan of the project is over, as far as the physical interventions are concerned, there are institutions that can run with the community and the people-driven works, you know. This is what the Punjab project looked like. We got, you know, you could not, we are not spending across the state. It was critical, it's a 15-year project, and it's gonna finish in 2020. There's the Amritsar circuit right here, around the Amritsar International Airport. There's the Patiala, Roper, this area around Chandigarh. There's the interconnection which happens with the Grand Trunk Road or the Imperial Highway, connecting both the circuits. This is what our mapping, our research on various aspects, kind of including visitor footfall, nature of heritage, kind of said. There is a third point also in Punjab which would have been interesting to look at, and that's way down, that's Bathinda. That's somewhere here, there's a pointer. Yeah, here. And that's the road from Amritsar which goes all the way into Rajasthan, whereas this goes to Haryana and into Delhi towards this direction. If you want to go up to Dharamsala, you do this. That's where His Holiness the Dalai Lama is. And then to go to Kashmir. And through Chandigarh is where you go to into Simla and further into the Satluj Valley and then Kulu, Manali and that area. So this kind of fits in very well in the overall framework. And like I said, these are the four areas of interventions that were identified, which the bank, Asian Development Bank, made it mandatory for the state government to not just consider but follow, which is X amount of funding in the connectivity area, another amount for tourist destination improvements. The third output was enhanced protection and management of the tourism asset itself. There's the community bit which has started now, and then there's the training and capacity building across the verticals and laterally as well. The bank has a very clear understanding in terms of when they articulate what they want to impact, what should be the outcome, what should be the outputs. They do want physical indicators of measurement, which is an interesting way because as architects, planners, we don't quite look at the world like that, but it's useful. Otherwise, it could be very ambiguous, what have you achieved, you know. It shouldn't just feel good, it should also be measurable, I guess. The kind of interventions that were done, I mean, these are just a few visuals about some places there were pilgrimage attractions, other places there are, you know, more built heritage from, there are not so many, not really living heritage, but more in terms of monuments, and then some natural heritage sites as well. One of the big takeaway, one of the big impact projects from heritage perspective is this Gobindgarh Fort in Amritsar. People didn't know it existed, actually. It's quite interesting. This fort is about 45 acres. And I came across this fort in 95, 96 as part of a mapping exercise. Sat in the middle of a cantonment. Nobody knew that Amritsar had a fort, except it's not a cantonment, it's a military board. And through the tourism projects, I was writing out a concept in 2004-05 for tourism development in Amritsar, and I put my little toe into this fort. Said, look, this has to be conserved, and so on and so forth. It caught the imagination of the chief minister at that point, Captain Amarinder Singh, who took this up with the government of India that this fort has to be restored back to the community. It's the only building they have, Punjab has, of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, who's a very, very important king of, I mean, the only person who kind of established the Sikh kingdom. And interestingly enough, the parliament decided to hand over this fort to the government of Punjab. So around 2006, between 4 and 6, the fort, the ownership, the titles of the fort was changed, and it was handed over to Punjab. It's probably the only fort in the country where militaries actually changed ownership and handed a fort to the civilian government. So I would, again, if I had to make a little feather cap, I'll put that little feather in my hair, you know. There's a little anecdote around it as well, that what the army decided was that they were going to give just the square monument, and they were not going to give these ravelins because these did not have a definitive form. They were mounds with these overgrown moat. And I was writing out the proposal, and I was walking on the ramparts with a second lieutenant there. And he said, look, this will only be handed over when the boundary wall is made and it's cut out, carved out of the cantonment. And I said, but what happens to the ravelins? He said, that we're not giving you. So then this is the partnership I'm talking about. The Secretary of Tourism is where I took this problem to. She asked me to make a map on the Google image that what are the parts not coming as part of the handing over thing. She took it to the Chief Minister, and he flagged it at Government of India level, saying, look, either give me the whole fort or don't give me anything. So, you know, it's quite interesting to see that there could be very, very interesting fundamental partnerships between the professional, the bureaucrat, and the politician. So that, again, comes part of the governance story. It's important for you guys to know this, because, you know, God knows who's going to go out and engage with heritage in that particular manner. You can't think of heritage as somebody's going to give you a brief and you're going to fix a wall and go home. You're married for life to it, you know. So anyway, so the big investment of about 50 crores out of 300 is only into the Gobindgarh Fort. Of course, there are lots of current threats which will have to be managed, because now, of course, they say when the barfi is ready, everybody's there to eat. So that's where we are. So it needs to be protected in a particular way, but that's another story altogether. Anyway, so community participation is something which ADB has definitely asked government to put in place. So they have put in a community development cell, and they've got people on board and some interesting hands-on people who were working at the Amritsar level who've now kind of moved into the Chandigarh office level. And there are some activities, but like I said, I am not hoping too much, because 3 years is, the loan period gets over in 2020. I think 3 years is too short a time to make any regulatory changes, or actual human capacities take longer time. I mean, it's, again, I've mentioned several of these areas that we kind of deal with as part of any work in an urban area or a regional area when we're doing heritage management plans. And that comes to purely from the functional areas, which determines what departments you're dealing with and the kind of organizations you have to deal with when you are really doing your integrated plans. So here we're talking about, for access and connectivity, you're looking at the Public Works Department. You're looking at Forest Department, because the road has to go through a forest or access has to be given. Operation and management could be somebody completely different. Here it could be PWD, or it could be through public-private partnership. Similarly, if you're looking at infrastructure like water, sewerage, and so on, somebody implements it and somebody maintains it. And the scope for involvement of the private sector. All this becomes part of your framework of tourism destination development. Similarly, cultural heritage areas, cultural and natural heritage, you're looking at ASI, Department of Culture. There's several unprotected buildings, and in most cases looked after by Public Works Department or urban local bodies or rural local bodies. Similarly, ecotourism. And once, in most cases, the situation is that this is clearly worked out. These areas require some creative thinking, because you could be creating an asset and you want private sector to get involved, or you want community-based organizations to get involved. Our laws, unfortunately, are pretty underdeveloped in the sector of heritage to engage either private sector or to engage community-based organizations or civil society in some form, because it's kind of understood that assets are either public or private. The middle area, which is public spaces, in a combination of the role of both government and private sector, where civil society can take ownership, or new institutions, or even educational institutions can engage with, is something where our country is pretty underdeveloped in that particular area and needs more work. This is just the organizational structure, the way that ADB project is being done. Where is the, from the state government to the organizing at the capital level, you have a state level empowered committee, there's a particular role at that level. You have an executing agency and you have an implementing agency. You've got lots of line agencies to deal with whose assets kind of impact the experience of a particular space. And then you, of course, have how the project gets implemented. Like the Amritsar area is one particular zone, Chandigarh area is one particular zone. How do you detail the project? How does it get implemented? Who monitors it? This entire mechanism is what is worked out following the Asian Development Bank framework. This area about the roadmap for policy and institutional reform and capacity building and inclusive development framework. Now, this is something which is informed. Now, both the projects are feeding into each other. The tourism development project and the cultural heritage policy project have actually enriched this particular process. And I would like, I mean, whether this is very text-heavy presentation and does not have very glorious and beautiful pictures of before and after, it's important for people who are engaging with tourism to think about tourism in the ecosystem of planning, implementation, the players, and so on, and not confine ourselves to just a particular asset, is what I would like you guys to take away from this particular presentation. The key challenges and learning from this particular project is, like, I mean, I've already spoken about the output. Inadequate investment in access and improvement at cluster and circuit level is the challenge. And we do know a solution to integrate with other projects of the government, ensure convergence. Very important word, and this is something we've been able to look at in Hriday project for Amritsar. And then the tourism destination development plans, which definitely need to have some sort of a buy-in from whether you're doing city-level master plans or their regional plans. I mean, these planning documents that get produced, they unfortunately are not talking to each other. Departments don't talk to each other, so therefore the plans don't talk to each other. So at least for professionals, it becomes very important to look at this and see what is possible in terms of creating those platforms for dialogue. Similarly, in the case of whether it's amenities, here the problem is that the preparation of toolkits as vocabulary of development within those clusters must incorporate vernacular traditional architectural vocabulary, the above to be enabled through government policy in public architecture and infrastructure in heritage sensitive areas. This is and training and capacity building of the construction industry. See, whatever we design, I mean, you could have the best of plans, but the nature of site that we get is because the plans go to the public works department and they kind of use their guidelines and their particular design systems to make these facilities. So you may, in plan, it may look very adequate, but the moment it becomes a third dimension, it looks pretty appalling when you see what the PWD builds by way of toilets and parkings and so on. In fact, Ministry of Tourism funds a lot of those kind of projects, So these toolkits, I would imagine, again, there is a role of institutions like CEPT to actually develop these toolkits. Because these days, the next step that people tend to do is to pick up pictures from the internet, and they call it something. When you kind of throw in a lot of images and say this is, I see a lot of people do that in their presentations. You have a plan and you have a lot of visual referencing, which is off the net. But the moment somebody says, okay, I want this place, you want to enhance the experience of a place, to translate that visual reference into actual physical design. For simple things like toilets, I would imagine toilets are the most difficult things to design. Why do Indian toilets stink, It's not purely because they're poorly maintained. I think they're poorly designed as well. Protection, enhanced protection, management of natural heritage. inadequate understanding and skills at the project management unit and the project implementation unit. On good conservation practice, absence of conservation tourism management plan, huge, huge gap. As a professional engaging with them, even if it's, there's a lot of money to spend, this is my nightmare. Because I'm dealing with the implementation unit of the government in Amritsar and in Chandigarh. And the nightmare for them to simply understand what is, how to get the consolidation of that particular old fortification wall right. You know, everything starts looking pink and flat, you know. Big, big challenge in terms of understanding what is good conservation at that implementation unit. Participation of local community, again, the same thing, inadequate engagement. In management, top-down approach, inadequate team mobilized in that sector. Almost like to every 20 engineers, you'll have one community development person. This component of the project is mobilized at a fairly late stage of the project, as I've already explained to you. And this is something I tell the bank, because you know somebody would say, okay, bank does not say you have to have 1:20. But it has something to do with the project designers, and I would say I should take responsibility that when I was involved with the roadmap, I did not envisage this. I thought, okay, 5 components, this much money is adequate, karo, this is the time span, ho jayega. It doesn't work like that. Got to have detailing at a level, I mean, it's something which requires much more thinking. And unfortunately, the other thing that I find, that the work that we tend to do is multidisciplinary, but the people in the social sciences are not quite engaged. We don't engage them adequately in our work as architects and planners. In conservation, we've moved beyond just working with engineers. So we do work with, landscape architects, art conservators. I do work with sociologists as well, but not to the scale and level that it is necessary. So it's like 5 engineers, 5 architects, and 1 community development specialist. It's very skewed. Training and capacity building of limited skills for a lot of things, and now, of course, the social and financial aspects are the poorest. Even the fact that assets are being generated, who's going to do the operation and maintenance, which are sustainable? We use the word very often, but I'm not too sure how many of us really understand what does that mean. What activity gets housed in a particular building? How is it going to sustain itself both financially and socially? And is it going to completely get picked up and consumed by the big wigs, like the big tourism industry? Or is there going to be space for local community as well? When I say local community, I also mean the dhaba walas and the small enterprises that exist in a city. I don't literally mean every individual. So I'm not, you know, so that's, is there enough planning that ensures equity? The second, just to demonstrate where we are with Amritsar as part of Hriday now, is that okay, fine, there is cultural heritage, the Gobindgarh Fort in Amritsar. There is a tourism destination development happening around Amritsar. And now we have another scheme of Government of India that sprung at us, that was last year, is that of Ministry of Urban Development. And I must say that this is, in my lifetime, the first project where the Ministry of Urban Development I see engaging with historic cities. And I was mentioning this to Anne, that there are 12 cities that were identified by Ministry of Urban Development, which are historic cities, where they've asked us, where they actually procured heritage professionals to prepare the city Hriday plans. And Mr. Bimal Patel has a lot to do with this project, so I would say it didn't come from anywhere. It clearly came from people who were thinking. Mr. K.T. Ravindran, Bimal, and I think a couple of other thinkers who were kind of informed the contours of this project. And again, a very important experiment, which I would flag at all of you to look at, those of you interested in urban planning and heritage cities. The outline written out in that particular plan was that you've got to map your heritage, you've got to find your heritage zones based on mapping, you've got to do a gap assessment of infrastructure in those heritage zones, evaluate current projects, and come out with recommendations for infrastructure investment in those historic areas. I mean, I was most amazed because I hadn't heard of anything like this before in my professional experience. And it said, you've got to do infrastructure. So we brought in our own two bits into it. We looked at, okay, what is the outstanding universal value of Amritsar? In the heart of the world city is the Golden Temple. And in the writings of the teachings of the Sikh Gurus and the Bhakti Sufi saints, which is there in the holy book, there is a relationship of nature and culture and dignity to human life that comes at you again and again. I mean, I'm sure people know about what the Bhakti and the Sufi tradition is all about. So what we said was that infrastructure is not just physical. And I said, you know, infrastructure can be physical, utility, social, institutional, economic. And Government of India bought into it. You know, I could have just thought of roads and parkings, you know. The other thing I also said was that infrastructure could be within a site, could be in the setting of the site, could be between two sites, or it could be an offshore intervention to de-stress a particular site if there is overburden because of use and so on. So this particular thought on understanding infrastructure is what we shared on the City Hiraday Plan. And it was accepted. We also linked at the poetry from the holy book, which talks about air is the guru and water is the father and earth is the great mother of all. And it talks about the elements of nature like that. So we kind of use this as a particular to inform our framework of intervention, because there was a city level advisory and monitoring committee that of politicians, of the MLAs and the MPs and so on, to convince that where is our infrastructure type coming and what are we responding to when we look at heritage responsive infrastructure. So based on mapping of heritage, we actually identified the heritage zone, and this is the walled city. And right in the center is the Golden Temple. And we identified sites of nature and culture. This is where the Gobindgarh Fort sits. This is another protected monument, which is called the Summer Palace of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. We identified canals, historic wells, the water structures, also as part of our heritage mapping. We also did something else. We said we're not going to confine ourselves at just looking at heritage per se. We're also going to look at where is the city going now. And this is the master plan 2031, land use plan for the city of Amritsar. The walled city is right here. And right in the center is the Golden Temple. This is the Grand Trunk Road, which goes to Lahore. And this is a bypass that has already been built to bypass the city to go to the various cities this way, as well as to go to Atari, because anticipating that, you know, there's going to be better times and better trade connections, so people will need to travel, you know, trucks will need to move and all that. They've got series of these ring roads. That seems to be the solution that we've, or the 20th, 21st century solutions for cities. So what the city has also proposed or has put in place a BRT system in the northern part, which is implemented, about to be inaugurated. So we did an analysis saying that, look, what is going to happen to the old town? The moment the city grows like this in years to come, what is going to happen to the nature of air quality and the kind of transformation that may happen to the walled city with that kind of urbanization? It's almost like a traffic island, is that what I tell people? That people are going to run around the old town as if it's a traffic island. And they're all, and most people who come to Amritsar, actually it's a major tourism attraction. I would call it tourism because it's a tourism forum. It's pilgrimage or visitation to the Golden Temple, which is right in the heart of the walled city. So if the city is going to grow like that, and the number of tourists going to the Golden Temple is going to increase, what do you think is going to happen to the nature of urban fabric in the walled city? I'm sure you guys can find an answer to that. And if you want to protect the quality, the ambience of the setting, and this whole ethos of when the gurus founded the site where they put the golden temple, what was the kind of texture and the kind of lifestyle and what was happening around the golden temple and what happens even today, which will get displaced in years to come? And can we, through planning, actually impact that? So this is our mapping of heritage and the nature of projects that were identified for improvement. What is very interesting is, which I must share with you, is that what we came out as a nature of identification of problems and solutions for Amritsar. Parallelly, there was another exercise that was happening, which was for Amritsar as a smart city. Now, what happens with that and what was the finding? Because the framework of the smart city was, I don't know how many of you are familiar with that, is that you've got to, one intervention, pan city in infrastructure that requires to be done, and all types of interventions in infrastructure needs to be done in one geographical area. So one for all and all for one is the slogan of the smart city. Interestingly, when we were doing the Hriday plan, our plan was based on informal dialogue. It's not part of the project framework that we have to do large platform of open public consultation. But smart city required that. And I was amazed that by the end of it, by the time we finished doing our city Hriday plan by December last year, the smart city project proposal came out from community consultations. And what people said was that if there's one thing they want to improve across the city, is transport. And if there's one part of the city they feel should be beautifully done and with all kinds of interventions, is the walled city. So it was a jaw-dropping kind of a thing for me, because it was interesting that what we as professionals were kind of arriving at and what the community was seeking actually converges. Then it becomes the onus of course, where what gets hijacked or takes a different form and therefore it becomes problematic is part of life. But as students of architecture, I see myself as a student as well, if you're constantly engaging with a question, you realize that if your questions are right and your intention is right as well, people think similarly, you know. I don't want to get into too many details about the nature of intervention. I just want you to look at the nature of studies we did to arrive at the kind of interventions we did in the walled city, or we are doing right now. Like, our analysis of the walled city was that this is the Golden Temple, this is half a kilometer, this is 1 kilometer. The city is, if you're walking on the edges of the walled city, it's a kilometer to get to the Golden Temple. That was our rationale to say, look, you need to pedestrianize, or you need to manage your traffic from that particular perspective of achieving an environment which slows down movement, which they've achieved to some extent. But to be able to achieve that, you need to provide parkings on the periphery of the walled city. That they haven't achieved, which I think they will need to do through the smart city. Because if you're pedestrianizing the inner area, and there's a huge ambitious project which is already implemented as a state government initiative, which almost looks like a film studio, film setting of Amritsar, is from the town hall to the Golden Temple. A very interesting experiment in facadism. I mean it nicely, I don't mean in a derogatory way. That somebody has made an effort, a state-sponsored project to do facadism, put stone and cobble and pavers and pedestrianize a whole zone. And they call it the heritage street leading to the Golden Temple. I was very critical because I thought it's too artificial. But I actually, you know, and we were talking about pedestrianization in a different way. But what that project does, it was just about inaugurated about 2 weeks ago. Because it slows down people about 500 meters short of the Golden Temple. I went into the Golden Temple complex after a couple of months now, and I actually saw that people were more silent inside. Because, you know, if you're being pushed around and you're kind of parking and, you know, doing all that, and then you get immediately into a sacred site, you're carrying a lot of noise in your head. But because they've removed the traffic for about 500 meters, the ambience of the inside, people are behaving better. So it's quite interesting how space kind of impacts human behavior, like we're talking about behavior change. Though it is facadism, what is that movie, I forget? Rab ne bana di jodi type of, I don't know if you've seen that kind of setting they've got in that facadism. So very, very important. I mean, I'm going to pick it up for a comparative analysis, that what do we talk about conservation, about the spirit of the place, and here it's facadism and the spirit of the place. It's a very, very interesting experiment to look at. So these are the road projects we have to work with, and we are, I mean, something just again, like the city mayor and all that wanted us to improve 21 roads leading to the Golden Temple. We had to pick up projects that the government was talking about. But the kind of tweaking we could do was that we told them that, look, we are not going to just tar the road and put pavers. We've got to improve the stormwater management. Those kind of things, pressures we could, you know, bring into the planning, into this whole system. And I do kind of think these are small battles we are winning. And again, for more work in the future as well. So we kind of linked that project of 21 roads leading to the Golden Temple to a mobile app, maybe, that can be done, because that's part of the project. Because we had to do signages and so on also as part of the program. That maybe it'll be find your way to the Golden Temple, or from any of these 21 roads, could be a game, you know, for kids to play. So linking physical projects with educational ones. Second zone that I was talking about was the Rambagh Garden and the Rambagh Gate, which is an access which connects the summer palace of Maharaja Ranjit Singh to the walled city. And this is also coming out pretty well. We're going to be housing a city museum in the gate here. And the conservation work, through the Ministry of Tourism work, we were able to achieve the first phase of conservation. And through the Hriday project, we'll be able to put a museum inside that. So, you know, this is our little effort in convergence. So the kind of studies, we actually identified areas where we thought parking and multi-use facility could be put in to de-stress areas and pedestrianize areas. Government hasn't bought into this, but we were sneaky enough to identify, you know, because most Government of India funded projects require state governments to do a land bank, and state governments do not prepare them. Because nobody wants to give information to the other how many plots of land are available for planning. But this is the most vital information to get when you start any planning exercise, is map available land with with the local governments. So it's a part of the project. Then of course the Gobindgarh project, and making linkages with other open spaces is something which we're trying to achieve. So connectivity to the walled city, I mean, my point to them is that we should be able to walk from one particular, like here's a platform 6 of the railway station. One should be able to do the Gobindgarh Fort, get on a rickshaw, or walk across, do the Golbagh, be able to enter the walled city, do the Golden Temple, go out of the Rambagh Gate to the other part. The impeachability of city and interconnections, can we kind of enhance that through the Hriday project, you know, is what we're trying to achieve. Then the toolkit, like I was talking to you about, that translating a visual vocabulary into actual construction drawings is what is the need of the hour for any city, really. The nature of studies we did, because when we did the walled city study, linkage, you actually see the transformation of the edge of the walled city responsive to what is happening on the other side, or vice versa. And the nature of transformation that happens inside. You know how the two sides talk to each other. This was, again, one of our Eureka moments, to understand that how we were going to treat, we call the circular road as our zone 4. We call it the historic connector, because that's where the moat was of the walled city, which was filled up during the when the British took over Amritsar and made into a circular road. So there's nothing historic about what you find, except obviously there are these gates which are colonial period gates. You can say, okay, the gates are part of the walled city. Why is the connector linked? It's something which we call as a historic connector, as a heritage zone, because we feel it's fundamental for the health and of the walled city and, you know, important sites like the Golden Temple. So we strategically call it Zone 4 as our the historic connector. So it's just the kind of nature of studies that were done to think of solutions for this circular road, which cannot work unless we create those parking, you know, nodes for people, because we can't wish away people with their private vehicles. But we did, you know, think creatively about the circular road, but clearly it needs to be linked at the smart city level, and Hriday does not have the resources to deal with it at this point. So this is what the circular road looks like. That was the edge of the walled city, quite transformed, and there's an inner circular road, there's an outer circular road. And the kind of, when I showed you the studies that all those five different parts of the circular road look different, there's a part which is very residential, and the edge looks very green, not as green as this, whereas the other part, which is very commercial, so you start seeing shops which open onto the circular road. So there is a case for kind of doing what Patrick Geddes calls as a conservative surgery, that you work your bits in and see what you can recover as vital public spaces. Again, studies in terms of circulation, how the transport system can work and where the nodes can be to interchange between vehicular to the non-motorized and so on. Stormwater management. Of course, my planners felt that this is not where the water should go, because all the stormwater goes into these, what they call, some sort of drains, which falls into some sort of Gandanala, where sewage and stormwater mixes, and people find it funny that this goes into Pakistan. I don't think it's any funny at all. But to deal with stormwater at the local level, because the groundwater of the city and the larger region is depleting, so it's kind of important that water is kind of looked differently, stormwater is looked differently than just draining it away. Then, of course, our Upper Bari Dwab Canal, that's in our other engineering feat. There's a pump house here, British period, there's a power house here. So colonial heritage, which itself merits, I would say industrial heritage, not so much colonial heritage, which merits conservation and gives a potential, you know, again, opportunity for public space. I was telling the local municipal commissioner, maybe we should have a Coke studio here, you know, I mean, Punjabis love to sing and all that. So we can think out of the box while we retain our layers of heritage. So as a final slide, the outcome really is that we're looking at innovative and sustainable models for physical planning, financial, regulatory, legal, and institutional support for revitalizing heritage and historic areas in general, and the tourists will come. Greater opportunity for public participation, standards of excellence in every area of cultural and natural heritage, conservation and management. I can't convert myself right now, this is important. More opportunities for people to engage as creators or consumers of cultural goods and services. Heritage is dynamic. We can't say something which was created yesterday was good and today we are not capable. That'll be a lot of disservice to human ability. And then bottom up, people-centric approach to heritage management and tourism destination development. I mean, this is, whether it is Hriday or whether it's tourism or projects or it's cultural heritage projects, it all falls into the same box, you know, like all that water goes into the Gandanala. So it's like, so we cannot look at disconnect tourism development from other areas of work. And that's what has been our experiment or learning in CRCI, and it's been very enriching. So thank you so much.
interesting and quite exhaustive presentation. And I guess, as you have mentioned, it's a text-heavy presentation, but all texts are very, very important for us to know. And especially, we have heritage and tourism over here, very particularly.
Hello.
Yeah. So, well, I guess we should go for a question session for the audience. And I guess a lot of questions must have, you know, come up in your mind. Ask first, and then I have a couple of questions, definitely. Anybody?
Yes. Thank you, Gurmeet. I have actually two questions. One is in terms of cross-learning, which other countries do you think what they could learn from India or India could learn from them? That is the first one. And the second question is, could you say something about your specific or personal experience of working in Punjab? Because it's a unique part of the country, and we are here in Gujarat. You have worked in many different places. But how would you depict, let's say, your professional interactions in specifically Punjab?
As far as countries are concerned, I think there's a lot to learn from several countries. At least as my own professional practice, every 2 years I've gone to some country or the other to do some to study some program or the other, and I think now I feel a bit embarrassed, probably I become the oldest student. For instance, my last engagement was as on a program on arts management supported by the Goethe Institute, and that was Germany. And that's when the question that I was engaging with was about culture and cultural heritage and peace and role of culture in peace and reconciliation, because Germany's got to deal with it in a huge, huge way. And Amritsar's had issues like, we've had partition, we've had the Jallianwala Bagh, and then the 1984. And here we're looking at heritage. You can't wish away histories which are contested and histories which are uncomfortable. So I feel the world, I mean, it's like a small place now. So when I was engaging with this particular idea, I went to the Topography of Terror Documentation Center in Berlin, or to look at the memorial to the murdered Jews of Europe. How have they looked at the sites of Holocaust, and how have they given them a place of dignity in the city of Berlin? I mean, it's tremendous learning. I mean, it was, and who made a difference on this is also very interesting, the narrative. Similarly, whether it's technical aspects, I mean, I look at the peace parks done by Kenzo Tange on Hiroshima, the World Heritage Site, or the Atomic Park, the A-Dome site, which is a World Heritage Site, the building. And that's where I kind of understood that, you know, people come, they see, you need a symbol, you need a place to contemplate, you need a place to engage. And then I kind of re-looked at the Golden Temple, and I saw that, okay, even in the Golden Temple, there is a symbol, there's a place to participate and contemplate. And I saw the parallels between Kenzo Tange's Peace Park and the Golden Temple. So like that, one can go on and on and on. There is something to learn from everywhere, you know? Depends what your questions are, you know, what you're at any given point of time. And about Punjab being unique, I would say any place is unique. I worked with the National Trust for 3 years, and I realized, this is soon after my master's in conservation, and I realized that I should not be working in Punjab to begin with, to develop my own vocabulary on conservation. The reason being that, you know, I mean, I remember going to Karnataka at one point, going to somebody's house, and they offered a glass of water. And I drank the way we drink, you know, you just put it to your lip and drink it. Then I saw other people pick up glasses of water and kind of pour and not touch it. I said, oh my God, I mean, I must have looked so gross to them, you know. So it kind of was important that, look, I understand Punjab because I am a Punjabi. And Sir Bernard Fielden, who I consider as my principal mentor in conservation, said that about his own work. He says, look, he said he was a provincial architect. You work local, but you know, you can think global, but work local. And he kind of framed this for himself as a provincial architect. And he was knighted for his work, but he kind of never left his home place. So to, you know, you get your grounding, your nourishment, and then you're ready to, then you can nurture any other place. But it does help you understand oneself better.
Anyone? So let me ask my question. As you have mentioned at the beginning of the presentation that ADB has already fixed the percentage of fund where how much should be allocated in terms of percentage, that this much percentage has to go there and this much. So what is the rationale over deciding that, number one, and what is the role of economics over there? Because that's a very popular discussion, because whenever we are talking about valuing a particular heritage, the conventional way, economics approach is something else, and conservationists look at it a little different way, you know. And at the end of the day, whatever we are going to achieve, it's all about generating that particular value, and probably through experience we are trying to achieve that particular value. Now this value discussion some or the other way, because at the end of the day it is tourism, at the same time it is for the people, the localites, because both the groups are constantly interacting and will interact definitely. So how do you deal with that part, that is heritage economics, and what is their rationale? Because ADB is definitely, it's a bigger organization. They must have very strong rationale behind that. Yeah.
See, as far as capping how much fund in which of the outputs was concerned, they clearly said they capped as the maximum that you can spend in a particular sector, not the minimum, because their problem was, I'm not too sure, I'm not privy to the figures. Like for instance, I know that the only time this argument was coming up that no more than this was in the access and connectivity bit, because most people wanted to make more roads, like Himachal wanted a loan, and Himachal, all these mountain states in India get 90% as grant and 10% as loan. Whereas the states in the plains get 90% loan and 10% is grant. So they've got to pay back. So Himachal wanted to fix all their multi-storied parkings in Simla and other places and wanted to do roads. So they kind of insisted that this is not a road infrastructure project. So maximum in the roads can be 25. In heavy duty infrastructure can be 25%. You cannot cap, that was capped. Between amenities, conservation, and community, it was up to the state. That was more as a deterrence, so that they don't spend too much on the road, not so much on. The second part is that on your economics bit, if you look at the loan document, the covenants of the loan, the reform at the state level, institutional reform in financial aspects like public-private partnership or community-based tourism and so on. The government, the bank actually requires the state governments to make policy changes. It's part of the loan covenants. But because it's a loan, beyond a point they can't crack the whip. If the state government decides not to do anything, the bank still has to be polite. That's the reality. If it was a grant, you could be more strict. But because it's a loan, and government has to pay back, and bureaucrats have that arrogance, keep, you know? So I wish I had a more technical answer to this one. But it's interesting to, it would again be interesting to examine the loan document, see how it plays out on the ground, and ask questions, and maybe find answers.
Thank you.
Gurmeet, I thought your description or your explanation about what tourism is in terms of it being, instead of understanding it as tourism, which is more recreational in its understanding, look at it as a process of a person traveling and the host and traveler relationship. I thought that was really beautifully put, because it really changes the perspective on tourism. And it also, in a way, puts the onus of conservation or heritage management onto the aspect of cultural exchange rather than the visual recreation or beautification aspect that usually is in the center of both of these. So I thought that it's just not as much a question, but more of a kind of an extension of that comment, that I thought that was really a big takeaway for me. You also linked it with the idea of authenticity, and the fact that when, and also I do believe that when you talk about cultural exchange rather than the visual consumption of culture or heritage, one understands authenticity very differently. And it's not the visual authenticity, but the authenticity of processes. So I just wanted to make a comment that was one of the very big takeaway from your lecture. And thank you for that.
Any more questions? Yeah.
Hi, I have a small question on the method, as to how does one engage with the community for that matter. Because the way I understand community participation is that, it just doesn't happen, and that it needs to be designed for that particular, for participation to happen. So how does community participation work for a model like yours for that?
Thank you.
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. There's a tool that we work with, which is called cultural mapping. And when you do cultural mapping, it's not just the built heritage. You map spaces, how they're used. You map activities, you map community groups, and so on. You also map local institutions, whether they are civil society organizations, or it is, formal and informal both. So if you were to, and if you kind of do, maybe if you were to just kind of engage in that particular thing, because that is a fundamental step when we get down to using a tool called, when we want to do the heritage impact assessment. Any intervention in a particular historic city, historic area, or a culturally sensitive area, you're going to do an impact assessment. To do the impact assessment, you've got to do mapping on all different dimensions. Now, the moment you start doing mapping, you kind of start understanding who are these people and what, because you've also gone in with a particular question or a project or a program or a process. So you also go in with a particular need, no? So between your needs and mapping the ground, something starts happening. If you were to just there's a film on our website called Lime Buildings Breathe. And maybe if you were to watch that film, because I didn't know about mapping like that till we embarked on restoration of this unprotected temple in the middle of a very, very poor village in Punjab with very, very poor human development indicators. You know, all Dalit population, landless, and most of them were combine workers, alcoholics, wife beating, all that was happening. And there was this lovely little temple, belonged to the Thakurs. The Thakurs had left because of 1984 and those kind of problems. And how did they get their act together? Engaging with the temple. And then we went in to restore the temple. And what did the people start telling us? It was, I got some support from one, because the MP was Mr. Vinod Khanna. So he got some studio to help us document the process. I've got about maybe 50 hours of footage of interviews, of conversations. That I would say, the film is just 1 hour, but that footage is so revealing in terms of what cultural mapping is. I should give it to some archive, you know, just to understand the conversations that happen around sites. Yeah?
Anybody else? No? Should we conclude the session? Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for coming here and giving a different kind of insight to us, to our students. And I must be very thankful to our audience, our students, and especially Manvita ma'am, Debashish sir, and Professor Kadam is here, and definitely our dean and finistra, Jigna, and Ashish. All of us are here. And our students, especially heritage tourism and the students, postgraduate and undergrads. Thank you for being here and having a different kind of interaction. I guess she would like to come once more, maybe next semester. We'll call always. And thank you. So let's just conclude the session. Yeah.